The following is a conversation with Mark van Vught, evolutionary psychologist and professor at the Free University of Amsterdam, the Netherlands, recorded for 45 Graus, a podcast based in Portugal. Bem-vindos! Como já perceberam, esta conversa foi gravada com um convidado estrangeiro. Na verdade, já a gravei em junho, na altura em que me debrucei sobre este tema da psicologia evolutiva. Mas como já seria, na altura, o terceiro episódio seguido sobre este mesmo tema, e tive receio de vos dar uma overdose deste tópico, decidi só publicá-lo mais tarde. É, na verdade, uma conversa de apenas 40 minutos, mas com muito conteúdo. Mark van Vught é uma das referências mundiais neste campo. É professor na Universidade Livre de Amsterdão e colabora com o Institute for Cognitive and Evolutionary Anthropology da Universidade de Oxford. Não sei se se lembra, mas o Paulo Finuras falou dele durante a nossa conversa sobre este mesmo tema. Foi então um privilégio voltar a discutir este tema, ainda que só por 40 minutos, com uma pessoa de referência desta área. Antes de vos deixar com a conversa, tenho de fazer um aviso prévio. Ao voltar a ouvir a gravação, fiquei com a impressão desconfortável de ter falado demais. Enfim, é o reverso da medalha do tema me entusiasmar. Mas vamos à conversa, espero que gostem.
Okay, Mark, thank you for accepting the invitation for this conversation on the podcast. I wanted to talk about your latest book, Mismatch, which, as the name indicates, is about evolutionary mismatches, which is what happens when our primitive brains reply supposedly correctly to stimuli, but in a way that would be correct in prehistoric times, but is not correct anymore, or is not beneficial to ourselves anymore. This is a very interesting issue, obviously, and is at the bottom of evolutionary psychology. It's something that is dealt across a wider array of books. You mentioned in your introduction Yuval Harari's books, for instance. But in this case, your objective with this and your co-author's objective is to not focus on one specific type of mismatch, but rather describe the whole range of mismatches that exist. Right. So I think I'll ask you to start on that. So to, well, give any more information on the book that you find relevant and also discuss the most relevant mismatches, if you will.
Okay. So yes, you're right. This is not a book that focuses on one specific example of evolutionary mismatch. Instead, we wanted to bring this very interesting concept to a broader audience by, I suppose, speculating about how evolutionary mismatch can account for some of the challenges that we face as society today. So the basic idea is, yes, biological evolution of our bodies and minds is a slow process, which has happened over many, many generations, over thousands and thousands of years. And of course, if an environment quickly changes as a result of something that is happening, a natural catastrophe or something that humans have done, then we may find that our bodies and brains are no longer adapted to this new environment. And we try to show that, at least theoretically, this can be the case. And we then try to come up with lots of examples where we find that the mismatch principle can have some relevance, for example, in our bodies as they adapt to a new environment with, for example, cars and traffic, airplanes, something that, of course, wasn't around a long time ago when our ancestors developed their bodies and brains. And so health, bodies, love, war, leadership. These are some of the examples that we've tried to develop in our book.
Yeah, one of the issues you mentioned, and is quite an interesting one, is stress, which is evolutionary tool which makes complete sense in our previous life, so to say, but that nowadays it affects us in a way that's completely beyond what it was meant to be a tool for. So we feel, or some of us feel, levels of stress that are persistent and not point in time, so not a reaction to a lion behind a rock, but rather a reaction to stresses at work. And that's, do you think that's one of the main mismatches, or at least one of the most impactful nowadays?
Probably, yes, certainly at work. And we spent an awful lot of long time at work nowadays. And so, yes, our stress system evolved in response to acute dangers and threats. And so our stress system, as it were, when it's activated, it signals to the body that it's important to do something, to fight or flight, and then it sets in motion a sudden rush of hormones, cortisol, adrenaline, in order to cope with that threat. But the threat is acute. And for example, as you say, a lion running towards you, immediate action is required. And once you've escaped, then the stress system sets is deactivated, basically. Mm-hmm. Yes. So what we have now is almost a permanent stress from living in a modern, urbanized and working environment where we have deadlines to take care of. We have maybe conflicts with co-workers who we don't have any kinship relationship with. And they are stressful, but at a sort of at a lingering level. But they do affect us physiologically. It affects our sleep and rest patterns. And it also affects our hormonal household. And so this sort of continuous secretion of cortisol that we experience now in response to these daily stresses are affecting our health, are affecting how our bodies respond, are affecting our sleeping patterns and the decisions that we make. And so, yeah, that's certainly one example of mismatch that we discuss in our book.
There's an interesting bit of information which I think you mentioned, which is the fact that in ancient times, and if we still study the hunter-gatherer tribes that exist today, we don't find anyone experiencing insomnia, for instance, which is a very interesting phenomenon.
Yes,
in that it tells us that insomnia is completely, or at least to the most part, related to our present lifestyle.
Yes, no, but what we try to say is that there are so many cues in the environment that are different. For example, humans evolved in Africa, and so the day-night shifts are fairly fixed across seasons, and so. We now live, at least I, in the northern latitudes in the Netherlands, where there's a clear distinction between seasons in day and night rhythms. And so our bodies are probably fairly ill-adapted to cope with that. And hence, that's one cue, of course, that is very different. So we have very long summers. I mean, it almost doesn't get dark nowadays in the summer. And it almost doesn't get light in winter times. And so our body has to cope with that. And so that, I think, is, of course, a source of stress, which causes here insomnia. And then there are all these other cues related to work, related to the fact that we interact now with lots of genetic strangers, people we don't have any familiarity with. And so that is emotionally exhausting as a sort of more extreme form of stress. We talk about burnout. Well, one of the aspects of burnout is depersonalization and cynicism. We get that in contact professions like teaching, but also nursing. Well, what characterizes these jobs is that we are asking people to empathize with complete strangers, lots of them on a daily level, at schools, in hospitals, etc. No wonder that people depersonalize and suffer from cynicism and emotional exhaustion. We haven't evolved to cope with that problem.
Yeah, we were made for face-to-face interaction, right?
With kin, people who we have a deep emotional connection with, because we have a shared genetic interest.
Let me ask you something about going a little bit towards the root of the issue in a point you just mentioned about the fact that we as a species arose in Africa and then we spread out in the last roughly 50,000 years. I would guess that's one of the most one of the greatest difficulties in this realm, which is to understand to what extent did we evolve since then, because we know that 50,000 years ago is already a lot of time, although evolutionary arguably is not too much,
right.
But it's already enough for we to be all across the world the same species but with different features, and even with some physical differences. For instance, the northern peoples are different from the Ethiopians, right, for instance, in terms of body fat and stuff like that. Isn't it possible that we have evolved to adapt to these differences in environment, for instance? This going back to your example about the sunlight and the season.
Yes, no, that's of course an interesting question, and that is really gets at the core of the mismatch theory, and that is, well, if you assume that human evolution goes very quickly, very rapidly. And for example, if you say that, well, since the last 10,000 years ago, the agricultural revolution, if you argue that humans have evolved many different physical and psychological adaptation to cope with this change, then, of course, the mismatch argument is invalid. But all our research, and I'm talking about genetics, anthropologists research, archaeology research, neuroscience, points at the fact that, A, biological evolution is indeed a very slow process, and B, humans itself, our hardware, isn't really fundamentally different whether you talk about a person growing up in a small village in Ethiopia or a hunter-gatherer society in New Guinea, mm-hmm. or who lives in Denmark and is working for a company there. Our fundamental biology hasn't changed, and that means that you can recognize a Homo sapiens everywhere you go, and the Homo sapiens is very different from any of the other species that are now extinct.
Yeah.
And the reason why we can be so similar is because we have culture, and culture is a buffer against all these sort of new changes that we encountered when we moved out of Africa.
And we've outsourced, in a sense, our evolution to culture, didn't we?
Yes, and so we have our culture is in our clothes, for example, is in the way we use technology. Our culture is in our dietary preferences, etc. But again, they haven't fundamentally changed our hardware. So we are everywhere the same. Of course, you can point at physical differences, but they are really very small. We talk about skin color, for example. But that is a small difference that is really driven by one genetic change, one gene version that is different that causes a lighter skin color. But most of our psychology, the kind of decisions we make regarding who we prefer as our partners, who we want to cooperate with, these are complex psychological adaptations, and they can't really change in 50,000 years ago, let alone in 10,000 years ago. They've been built up very slowly over probably hundreds of thousands of years.
Mm-hmm. And also we do know that... And you mentioned that in the book, I would call them cognitive biases. I think you call them ancestral features, which are biases that we know exist in our behavior. And the most reasonable explanation for them is the mismatch principle, is that they were created for an environment we don't face nowadays anymore. And actually, I'd like to explore a few of them. Just let me ask one question before. This is a puzzle I have. I'm not sure if it is very much related, but I have a hunch that this may be explained at least a bit by evolutionary psychology. You mentioned burnout just a while ago. This is a very interesting phenomenon. This is obviously a big problem nowadays. But I've been noticing, or I've been thinking about a curious aspect of it. If you look at the political realm, for instance, not to mention the business one, but let's stick with the political realm. If you look at presidents and prime ministers, one, I think is very rare to observe a case of burnout, and two, is very rare to observe the case of someone who is in power, has a chance to continue in power, so to run, to be reelected, doesn't choose to do so. Which would tell me that there there's kind of a counterforce acting to compensate the pressure of that activity, of that role, because people want, this is one of the most high pressure, these are the most high pressure jobs in the world, but people want to stay, if they have the opportunity, most of them want to stay in that job. It's very rare for you to find a case of a prime minister or a president
yes.
who chooses voluntarily to step down if he or she has the option yes. to stay in power, right?
Yes, no, but that I think it's an old evolutionary principle at work that transcends humans. You see it in all the non-human primates as well, and that is once you've climbed up the hierarchy of your group, there is a strong incentive to stay there because the position in the hierarchy, certainly in our ancestral environment, and I'm talking now also about our primate mm-hmm. ancestors, not just humans, but as soon as you're at the top of the hierarchy, there are privileges and rewards in terms of status and also reproductive success that you don't easily give up that that position. And so maybe there is a mismatch there because being a prime minister today doesn't nearly give you the rewards in terms of reproductive success in a democracy, at least, as in our primate cousins. Because if you're the alpha in a gorilla, you have all the matings, all the females are yours, and all the children in the group are yours. And so there's a big, big incentive to fight for. And so we don't have that in our modern environment, probably in democracies, but still the psychology is the same. Once you're in the top position, don't easily give up your place. And so if you're not in a democracy, but in an African dictatorship, and you are not the top boss, but you are a civilian, then it's very hard because what we see left and right is that these African dictators, and not just in Africa, I'm thinking China now too, they want to maintain their power position and expand their power position, but they're really responding to a very old psychology, an evolved psychology that says, once you are there at the top, don't give up.
Mm-hmm. And my intuition would be that there's something at a biochemical level that acts as a counterweight to the burnout pressures, that something that acts as a pleasure sensor or something that counterweights that and give you
it's dopamine, it's testosterone,
exactly,
and they and we know that these are power comes with rewards. Mm-hmm. You can measure that by looking at dopamine levels in people. And high testosterone individuals also seek out these powerful positions. Their whole body, as it were, screams for power.
Exactly. You just mentioned leadership. That's also a very interesting field of this realm of evolutionary psychology. And you have also written about that. One of the most interesting aspects of it is the fact that we, unlike our primate cousins, we have evolved from a dominance hierarchy to one which is more based on prestige, which is
exactly,
based on reputation. That's already very interesting in itself. And also one of the assumptions, or I say assumption because I don't think is we can ever come to a complete conclusion on this, is the fact that during our hunter-gatherer times, which, as I mentioned before, is the bulk of our time as a species, we lived under a more egalitarian ethos, which means that those tribes or even those groups before being tribes were roughly egalitarian. To what extent can we know that, and how did this prestige versus dominance duality work out back then?
Yes, very, very good question. And so, yeah, we first of all have to consider different timelines here. And so we're talking about a very, very long history as primates. I mean, primates have been on this planet for maybe 60 million years ago or something like that. And so we share a common ancestor with a lot of primates living today, the chimpanzees, the bonobos, the gorillas, the orangutans, whatever. And so, and what characterizes all of them, bonobos are a little bit exceptional, but is indeed dominance hierarchies, where individuals compete for resources and naturally form some sort of hierarchy. Now, what happens with humans particularly, and that was the human niche, if you like, is something that happened about 3-4 million years ago, is when the niche for humans started opening up, and that was the savanna environment. And in the savanna environment, you had to survive, you could only survive by forming these highly cooperative groups. And so dominance was really not the currency on which groups could function well. And so in these groups, there was a really active suppression of any dominant behaviors. And so how do we know that? Well, we look at current hunter-gatherer societies. There are still a few on this planet who have a tribal structure that looks, we think, like what ancestral group living was for these couple of million years ago. We, of course, look at archaeological records. We look at neuroscience. So, for example, in neuroscience and in social psychology, there have been very many studies looking at, for example, our inequity aversion. We don't really tolerate as humans that one individual is better off than us, particularly if they haven't worked for it. So there is this sort of very strong sense of fairness and a strong sense of reciprocity. And that must come from somewhere. And we think that that comes from this period of egalitarianism that lasted from about the origin of humans 2-3 million years ago to about 10,000 years ago when the agricultural revolution kicked in. And again, there, what happened then, and that's really what mismatch is about, people were more or less released from this strong and strict egalitarianism that characterizes these small cooperative groups. And so what we call these leveling mechanisms that were part and parcel of these small egalitarian hunter-gatherer groups, they started to disappear. Leveling as in sanctioning or punishing individuals who were dominant, who were shown dominant or exploitative behaviors. These were no longer in place in these agricultural societies. And so suddenly there was opportunities, again, for particularly corrupt, nepotistic, but also the dominant authoritarian leaders to emerge. And that's really, we've evolved as a sort of democratic egalitarian ape, where leadership was really prestige based. The best hunter got the best rewards, the best diplomat, the best warrior, but their influence, their power was limited really to their domain of expertise. Well, we moved from that to a situation where leadership was no longer prestige based, but it's now again based more on dominance, authoritarianism, formal positions in the hierarchy, the CEO, the president, the king, etc. And so that's a mismatch.
One of the most relevant things that arose during those times was, of course, language. Where do you stand on the old debate on the origins of language? As one of the hypotheses is gossip, so it emerged as a tool for socialization. Another one, at least, is that it arose as a signaling device, so to signal intelligence, to signal gene quality. And there are even other options. Where do you stand on that debate?
Yeah, so I think, I have to stick with the social hypothesis of language. So language as a way to bond and connect individuals in increasingly large groups. So it was a language as a sort of coordination device. I mean, gossip is one aspect of it, but it's also making sure that you manage your social relations, even though you're not in this at the same time, at the same place all the time. You're not in each other's face. And so, but you can still transmit information. And so once that is in place, I think, once there are these group benefits of language, then of course, individuals who are excellent at language skills, who are orators or politicians nowadays, or poets, or they could show off their skills and maybe attract opposite sex partners by showing off their language, showing off their genetic quality. But I think first there must be some sort of group level benefit for language to emerge so that it's a system for a relatively honest system for transmitting social information. And then it can be hijacked or used by particularly skillful individuals to get these genetic benefits.
That's an interesting point. Your point is that there must be a benefit to the group before there's a benefit to specific individuals for a feature to...
Yes, because why would you respond to somebody showing some or transmitting some information if it's deceptive, for example?
Sure. No, it makes in my opinion, makes complete sense. You identify, and you just touched on that just now, you identify different types of leadership that were probably existent back then. And that's really very interesting because it tells us that a lot of differences in personality and difference in behavior and types that exist today, which seem to be very disparate to us, are actually, they have their roots back then. So nowadays we see people whose mating strategies, for instance, are based... When I say mating strategies, I mean the persona they create for themselves, which is obviously rooted in their personality. Some of them, they are the sportsman or sportswoman, so someone who is very good at sports or very good in physical activity. Other people behave more as managers, so the conscientious and responsible person. Others are the diplomat, if you will. Others are the know-it-all, if you will, so someone who is very good at language and very knowledgeable. And what's interesting is that these were different in your view, and I think that's a very relevant point of view. These were different leaderships that emerged in different environments back then.
That's right. But also, I mean, we humans are niche constructors. We are cultural animals, but we're also always, as individuals, looking for some opportunity to display our talents. And so as a group living species, in many different kinds of environments, we can occupy lots of different niches. Indeed, you can get status in a group by, of course, being a good hunter, providing some public good that is beneficial to others, but also as a diplomat, as a manager, as an explorer. And so you would expect individuals in a prestige-based hierarchy, because that's what our sort of egalitarian past was, a prestige-based hierarchy, you would expect them to look for opportunities to display talents and work on talents that are ultimately beneficial to the group, because that's the way that they can get status. And so you see that among children as well. Even in a family with sons and daughters, each of them tries to occupy a niche where they can be better than the others, if you like, and they can and so
differentiate.
They can differentiate. Mm-hmm. Yes, with that you have different personality. You get personality variation, which ultimately builds on probably genetic variation. And so, and I think it's great, and it's probably one of the secrets of the success of our species as humans, is that we can occupy so many niches as individuals, thereby fostering our own reproductive interests.
Yeah. Let me go back to the cognitive biases that we have, the ancestral features of our brains. Those are...
No, there's an important point here, because I don't think people who read Kahneman's work, for example, will realize that when they talk about these heuristics, that they probably have a very deep evolutionary functional history. Mm-hmm. And so you can go through all these biases that Tversky and Kahneman found, from loss aversion to the endowment effect and whatever. And there is probably some story of some functionality in our ancestral environment, which is currently leading to perhaps maladaptive decisions in a new environment. And so people don't often realize that, but I think it's a very important message to convey.
That's in my opinion, that's one of the most interesting aspects of this field. Is that
you're an economist,
yes, so you think about it. Exactly. It really enables us to go to the root cause of this issue. Yeah. As you mentioned, Kahneman or Robert Cialdini's book, also very, very well known in the field of psychology. But studying this from an evolutionary point of view enables us to go to the root cause of all those biases that exist, all those things that we notice that don't follow necessarily a rational path. But rather, our heuristics are shortcuts for decisions that are really embedded in our hardware. And that's really very, very interesting.
Yeah, so I thought a little bit more about this question, and I don't think our book totally deals with that. But so what I'm suggesting here is that we have evolutionary old problems, mm-hmm. things that have been around for many generations and are still around with us today, like how to find a mate to have your children with and live a long life. With, etc. How to find a place to eat or sleep or whatever. These are evolutionary old problems, and we would expect our heuristics, our system one, if you like, our intuition to do well with these kinds of problems. So we don't need to evoke our prefrontal cortex. We don't need a lot of deliberate thought. I mean, how does it happen? You go to a bar, a party, to student accommodation, you find someone, you fall in love, etc. Mm-hmm. That's it. So evolutionary old problems can be dealt with very well with its heuristics. But evolutionary novel problems, things that haven't been part and parcel of our evolutionary history, like climate change, for example, or where to get a mortgage from, or how to invest in our pension. For these kinds of problems, our evolutionary heuristics are mismatched, and they actually require a lot of deliberate thought, prefrontal cortex activation, etc. And that is where system two comes in. And where we encounter problems is when we apply system one to evolutionary novel problems, or vice versa, where we apply system two thinking to evolutionary old problems for which we have heuristics. And I think it's at that cross-section where Tversky and Kahneman's work is relevant.
Sure, that's a very interesting perspective. I hadn't thought about it in that way, in that...
We should do more research on that, but I think that's really what is happening.
It's indeed very, very interesting, because it tells you that not everything is a mismatch. So there are heuristics we have which are not... Maybe they could be they could become more perfect or more accurate, but they are not mismatches.
We have to find the ecologically relevant environment where they can be applied well.
Yeah, and it immediately came to my mind the you mentioned the example of falling in love, so mating in a more technical description. It immediately came to my mind an example I saw, and I think I mentioned this in the conversation with Glenn also, which is the fact that we know that women tend to prefer, and this obviously the same feature exists in reverse, but from the point of view of women, they tend to prefer men. We have facial features which reflect high levels of testosterone. So the whole chin thing, the forehead, you know all that, of course. And what's interesting there is that research, at least so far, tells us that that preference, it gets diluted as societies get developed. So that's really a preference that makes sense in an environment of scarcity. It doesn't make sense in an environment in which you have plenty of access to food and other needs. And so there's like an automatic mechanism in that in more developed societies, like the Netherlands or Sweden or other Scandinavian countries, that effect is really, really much more diluted. And it tells us that we have hardwired in us the sort of the response with different levels of...
Yes, environmental contingencies. So, yes. Conditions under which we are more likely to select particular mates, for example, those that are more masculine or less masculine.
What's interesting,
our minds is heuristics, yes. Yeah.
What's interesting, and this is why I think your point is very relevant, is that the same thing doesn't happen in the work environment. So we don't have an automatic adaptation there, which tells us that there's clearly a mismatch, and we're really not being able to adapt.
The system is not very well calibrated.
Yes.
We try to calibrate it through education, for example, mm-hmm. so that we prepare our children for the best possible working environment through schooling. But these are cultural experiments, and who knows what society looks like in 20, 30 years. So our education may calibrate children.
For the best.
Yes, towards a particular thing, but the future may be very different. And that's clearly, so in the book we talk about evolutionary mismatch primarily, but there is also a lot of developmental mismatches and even cultural mismatches. Mm-hmm. I mean, look at all the sort of migrants in European society that come from different society, like culture of honor societies. So how can we explain that a third generation migrant from Morocco in the Netherlands still adopts cultural standards from the nation that their grandparents left? I think that there is certainly something like cultural mismatch at work,
mm-hmm.
which I think is another very fascinating topic to speculate on, because it may be very important for kind of problems that we're also facing in society with social cohesion and how to deal with the refugees and what have you.
Yeah, exactly. That's why all this field of evolutionary psychology, but also the field of culture, interests me so much, because they are really relevant to such a broad array of issues. And what, for instance, one issue you mentioned, I was very pleased to find that you wrote about, is the issue of climate change. And because it's I just recorded a conversation with a climate change expert here in Portugal. And really, our cognitive biases are really so much present there in our lack of response to climate change. And if you start counting them, tribal thinking, for one, focusing on the present, herd behavior, that is copying those the behavior of the ones around us and focusing only on our group, focus primarily on sensory experiences, so what we can feel with our senses. These are all biases or ancestral features that are really in the way of our response to climate change. That's
yes. So, but what I'm arguing is we can use these ancestral biases in order to get people to be more concerned about climate change.
Mm-hmm.
If we, for example, tap into people's immediate sensory experiences. So, for example, suppose you would have something added to your drinking water, your tap water, that would reflect the pollutants in the water, which vary from day to day, even what you get in your drinking water. And suppose the water company, I mean, they won't do it voluntarily, but they would add something which makes you which changes the color of your drinking water if it is slightly polluted.
Mm-hmm.
That would be a clear signal to which our brains would respond. And so we have to be clever and think about how we can use these evolutionary relevant nudges, if you like, so to speak, in order to change people's behaviors. And so we shouldn't go down the old route of education, information, and think that somehow helps. No, we should look at these biases, study them carefully, and say, okay, now we can sort of use these biases in a desirable way.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, it makes complete sense. So the benefit of one studying these subjects is that one can take better informed decisions based on what we've learned. Is not to cross our arms and quit. And for instance, the fact that we tend to focus on our kin, as you mentioned before, if the climate change effects are made relevant to our kin, so to our children, for instance, then our heuristics will tell us that it's necessary to.
We've just run a few studies whereby we prime people with pictures of children.
Mm-hmm.
In one condition, and in the other condition, we didn't have children. We just gave information about environmental consequences. But people respond more strongly if we emphasize or we activate children, because that promotes what we call a kin care motivation. And that we found that ultimately resulted in them having stronger intentions to engage in all kinds of environmental behaviors, from domestic water conservation to recycling, etc.
So
we should be clever about that.
Sure. Well, congratulations on that research. I think you're doing a very, no, really a very relevant and really something that's very significant for society as a whole, which is also obviously something good for our work. We're reaching the end of our conversation. I wanted to leave with a with a question that arose really in my mind when I was reading about this, and I guess you have the same experience. So in your, you are someone who is really well positioned to correct all these mismatches, and I'm sure you've tried to do so in your personal life or professional life. Which is the one which is really the most difficult one for you to to correct, either in your private life or professional life, due to the contingencies that you face in either of those?
Yes, that's a very good good question. I've been asked that question
really?
Various times. Yes, okay. Yes. And I give different answers because there are so many temptations that I struggle with in modern life. But the one thing, it has to be my eating habits, particularly
sugar.
It's now World Cup time, and when there's World Cup, lots of football on television, which I follow, and then I do buy a bag of crisps. Crisps are obviously a mismatch because in our ancestral environment there were not these very nice sweet, salty, fatty foods, and so what I cannot do is, once I've opened the bag, I cannot stop until the bag is totally finished. And so that's my problem. My evolved psychological mechanism says, oh, this is so tasty, keep on eating, keep on eating. There's nothing better in this world.
I think it's okay. I mean, one shouldn't be too judgmental in this field, and I think it's good to let our ancestral brain override
some urges.
Yes, yeah. our present knowledge of.
Yes, on the one hand, I still do the exercises. I still play football and do okay. some tennis so that I can try and restore some of the excess weight that I gained.
That's good. So you're balancing things out. So you're correcting.
It's a permanent struggle, which our ancestors didn't have.
Exactly. That's why they slept well. Mark, thank you very much for this conversation. It was a bit of a short one, but very interesting. You really gave me some very interesting insights on this topic. So thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Uma última nota para relembrar que podem tornar-se apoiantes deste projeto através do Patreon no site www.patreon.com/45 por extenso.
Obrigado a quem tem apoiado no Patreon, em particular ao Gustavo Pimenta, ao João Vítor Baltazar, ao Salvador Cunha, à Ana Mateus, ao Ricardo Santos, ao Nelson Teodoro e ao Paulo Ferreira. Até ao próximo episódio.